今日はファイアエムブレムサイファーの魅力や特徴などを皆さんにお伝えしようと思います。よろしくお願いします。
はい、さてファイアエンブレムサイファーの発売日が3日後に迫ってきたということで。
そうですよね、もういよいよ今週の木曜日、はい、今日は月曜日、
そうです、
月火水だと3回寝ればもう発売日
です、ね、
まあ、ちょっと河原さん忙しいから2回ぐらいしか寝れない。
そんな
すいませんけど、どうですか、
サプライズゲスト。そうなんですよ、サプライズお呼びしましょう。どうぞ
どうぞ。
誰だ。
はい、お店の中を見ていきたいと思います。はい、お、ここにはサイファのポスターたくさん貼っておりますね。あ、そして第5弾のポスターもあります。ありがとうございます。はい、そしてですね、こちらシングルカードも置いてありますね。綺麗ですね。サインカードも置いてありますよ。いいですね。はい、あ、そしてこちらには第4弾のポスター。あ、そしてカメラさん、ブースターパック置いてありますよ。第1弾、第2弾、第3弾、第4弾、第5弾、あれ？ない。どういうことでしょうか？これはちょっとジーク店員に聞いてみたいと思います。どういうことでしょうか？
大変人気でですね、売り切れてしまいました。申し訳ございません。
そういうことでしたか。ありがとうございます。
2015年6月の発売より、たくさんの皆さんにご愛顧いただいている TCGファイアーエンブレムサイファーにつきまして、10月1日に発売する第22弾をもって商品の展開を終了することにいたしました。つまり、第22弾が最終弾となります。
I think for a lot of people when we play certain types of games, whether it's story-based games or multiplayer games, at least for the people that have played card games in the past, you kind of have this thought, man,I wish this game had a card game version too, or I wish they made a card game out of this. And you know, I've had these wishes with plenty of games, and you know, games such as League of Legends even, which now has Runeterra, but I always had this thought with Fire Emblem, because I felt that Fire Emblem being a strategy type game always felt like, wow, this would convert really well into a card game format. And it did. On April 14th of 2015, Fire Emblem Cypher was announced.In Japanese, and so this was together with a bunch of big Fire Emblem announcements, and they basically announced that the game would be getting a Japanese release. And I was really thrilled by this. The first set released in July of that year, together with the release of Fire Emblem Fates. But unfortunately, after 5 years of incredible product, incredible production, and amazing memories, the game was announced to be cancelled on April 2nd of 2020.Together with its 22nd set release at the beginning of October, this was going to be the final set for the game, and unfortunately that would be the end of releases for Fire Emblem Cypher. So in today's video, I want to talk to you about the most unique card game community I've ever been a part of. Fire Emblem Cypher was a game that I think the best way to describe it is it's full of heart. Being dependent on a video game series, theCard game represented the characters and each different video game so well in their mechanics. Now, you had hero skills, you had like dragon veins from Fates being represented well, crest powers from Three Houses, just whatever you name it, they always managed to replicate. Hell, even the gacha aspect of heroes was well represented in Alphonse decks. And they always managed to just fit the flavor of a character or their character traits or video game's elements and mechanics and gimmicks.Into the respective cards excellently every single time. Outside of a couple specific cards, the power levels never felt too offensive. It never felt like it was insane power creep at any stage. Sure, the cards got stronger over time, but even to this day, there are still set one cards being used in some decks like Tiki, and you know, there's plenty of cards from earlier sets still being incorporated in the upgraded versions of those decks, even though they could easily be dropped. But it's because there was never any crazy power creep in this game that could actually stay the same.And you could barely ever feel if there was a stronger deck, you would ever barely feel it because of the way that the community is. Another thing that was amazing about the game is that it gave exposure to the older Fire Emblem games to those newer fans. So for example, if somebody came into Fire Emblem with Awakening or Fates or Three Houses, they could actually see what the characters looked like and what the kind of gimmicks they had because they were so well represented in the card game. For myself, I never played Genealogy of the Holy War or Thrakia, but the card game gave me a good flavor, a good taste of what those characters were, what they looked like, what the relationships were, because a lot of them work together in those ways in the card game, and that gives you a really good impression of, oh, so this was what old Fire Emblem was like as well. The art and backgrounds, I think for a lot of people that just collected Fire Emblem Cypher, the art and the backgrounds of the character art really gave a lot of extra life to characters. You know, you had promos that had, you know, almost like hero-like alternate skins and whatnot that basically just gave extra life to the characters, you know, just gave them another way of being represented and maybe gave them a new angle that you could look at them. You know, sometimes you would have arts that connected between different cards, and that would always kind of give you this feeling of like, oh, okay, this is, you know, kind of giving the extra feeling of characterization that you otherwise would not have had. Of course, the game wasn't without its own issues. You know, the game was quite expensive because the game never really reprinted cards outside of like promos, because it just never really did. It wasn't really a competitive type game, which I'll talk about soon, but rather it was more either for collection or for casual TCG fans or just Fire Emblem fans wanting to play a card game. But a lot of cards got pretty expensive. You know, we had Nino, we had Deirdre, we have like a bunch of different Korins. You know, it's like even now Byleth, like there's a lot of cards that hit really expensive price targets, which made the game pretty hard to get into. There's even a website that existed from the first year of the game called Osaifu Saifa, which means, Osaifu means wallet, so it's literally just cheaper budget versions of decks, because otherwise the game is pretty expensive. They also implemented a rotation, which, even though it existed, was never actually followed in Japan. During my time in Japan, I played in plenty of tournaments and they never cared about the rotation. They always said, oh, we just play unlimited, because it's not about being competitive with rotation, it's about just playing your favorite characters. But with that being said, you know, it's really painful to think about the fact that the next Fire Emblem story, whichever game it may be, will never see cards being printed. Whichever next Fire Emblem Heroes storybook will come out will not see cards, even though all of the previous ones have, and that is a very unfortunate thought. I've spoken a fair bit about the community and the way that the game is played, and I really want to emphasize the community. That's what this video is about, the community. This community for Fire Emblem Cypher, it was not a TCG community, but rather it was a community of people that love Fire Emblem that just get together over a card game. This was what really stood out about the community for me in Japan. So this is strictly in Japan, because when I lived in Japan myself, I got to experience this community, go to a lot of local events. There was local events in Tokyo every single day if you wanted to go, but they would sometimes have like offline meetings where there weren't even tournaments. They would just pair you up with different people and you would sit down and you would talk about, you know, your favorite game, your favorite title. You'd play out some games. Sometimes some of the top players that go to like the Japanese national events, they would give you feedback on your deck. Maybe they would say like, oh, you could try this card out. Oh, I see you're doing this, but maybe you should try out this different kind of like synergetic combo. And it was such an interesting experience that I've never felt from other card games. You know, in other card games, it's always about competition. Sometimes it's like memes and fun, but it's very much focused on the competition. It's very focused on events and regionals and all this stuff. Cypher never had that. It did have regionals. It did have national tournaments for Japan, but it never emphasized that part of the game. It was always about just community, the Fire Emblem community. Kawade P, so the producer of the game, ever since the beginning, from the announcement of the game until the very last live stream where he said thank you and goodbye to all the players, he said that he intended Cypher to be a communication tool. It's a communication tool for people that love Fire Emblem. And that doesn't mean that just people that love Fire Emblem already. I've met so many people in Japan that never touched a Fire Emblem game until Cypher, and then got into it because they love the art of the game, they love the mechanics of the game, and then they got into Fire Emblem Cypher, and it still functioned as that communication tool. The overseas community, of course, is quite big and very active. There's a lot of events being run all the time. Even right now as I'm recording this, I think there was an event tournament just the other day, you know, always running online events, making plugins online, whether it's on Lackey or CypherVit, you know, and just always being very active. There's a lot of discussion going on. It is more of the typical TCG community, with just being focused about tournaments and events and like playing the best decks. Whereas I felt that in Japan, it was very much so that it was just about, you know, there are more competitive players, but it was always about just getting together and having a good time, which I think of course exists in the overseas community as well. The really interesting thing that I remember from some of the Cypher events that I went to in Japan was that there would be times when I would be playing against people. I think almost every single event I'd be playing against people, and they would always say the lines of the move. So in Cypher, every card's effect has a title, much like in Buddy Fight, for example. And they would often say those move lines, and I remember there would be some players that really get into it, and they just like, you know, they I remember there was, I think, there was some really ridiculously long effects, and they would just say the entire ridiculously long effect, and, you know, start laughing about it and everything, and it just, that gave so much extra heart to the game, you know? And it's the community that's also adding that heart to it as well. And everyone really, the most unique part for me is that even though there was always like, everybody knew what the best decks were, everyone played with their favorite characters. Almost every single game, I played against different decks. Even if I went to a tournament every single day, I'd probably face a different deck every single time, unless there was like one popular character that everybody liked. But very often I was just like, wow, you can build a deck around this? Like, I didn't think this guy was even like popular enough for somebody to make a deck around him. But no, people manage and people do, and that's the fun of it. People just want to do their best with their favorite characters. And I think for more casual card game players, that is like a dream come true, because all you want to do is just have fun with your favorite deck. There were some card shops that kept like statistics of their top players, statistics of like the most best represented decks and colors and stuff like that. But on top of that, the shops gave extra heart to the game, because there were some big shops that would just host free tournaments. So you didn't pay anything, you just signed up, and they would have like 50, 60 participants. And what they would do is, for participating, you would get a free promotional pack. But then for each win you got throughout that tournament, you would basically get like an extra chance of winning a pack. So you basically, you drew lots, and then you basically got, if you got lucky, you got a pack. If not, you didn't, but it was free, so you didn't really care. You came there for the experience of playing with these people and engaging with this communication tool, rather than just like to win. So that was honestly a very unique factor that, again, gave the community and the game so much heart. It was always really fun to see just how crazy people would go to make their favorite character work. I think that was by far the most surprising thing, and that inspired me as well. Like, I have my favorite characters, and even though they're not that great, I want to make a deck that works around them, and that's what was the enjoyment of the game for me. Of course, the community wouldn't be anything without its development staff, and, you know, Intelligent Systems and Nintendo did an incredible job with Fire Emblem Cypher. The developers, you know, Kawada P, Young, and everyone else, they put so much love into the game. I cannot describe how much love and passion they had for this game. And it's just, I don't think I've ever seen this much love put into a card game from one developer. It is simply amazing. You could tell that they felt so much passion about their created game. They organized all these events, you know, not just like tournaments, but they would do like Cypher festivals where there would be like concerts, and you could get like signatures from artists and voice actors. And, you know, they would always show up at Comiket, for example, and talk to the people in the queue, talk to them about their favorite decks or Fire Emblem games or whatever. Keep in mind that Kawada P is the person that made Paper Mario, if I'm not mistaken. You know, these people aren't just card game developers. They are, you know, they are the developers of Intelligent Systems. They're not just doing this for just a card game. They are part of Fire Emblem as a franchise. They also like traveled around the country to visit different card shops and show them off during their live streams and stuff like that. They just supported the game so much. They even had like New Year banquets, like festivals, you know, just for New Year's. There was just so much going on for this game that they just put so much love into, and I cannot understate how important their support for the game actually was. On top of that, when you would buy new boxes of Fire Emblem Cypher, you wouldn't just get the cards, but they would always throw in random goodies. Like, for example, in this final set, they threw in some keychains, you know? They always throw in some sleeves. They throw in, like, hell, I literally use these quite a lot. They even give you little notepads. Literally notepads with different games, and I remember these were so cool. Like, I have, you know, I studied in these. You can see, like, I was doing studying from these Fire Emblem notepads that they gave out. Like, they would give out clear files, stickers, everything. You don't see other card games do this. This was because they knew that these are Fire Emblem fans that love the franchise, and they love getting these kind of freebies. And they all did that out of pocket. This wasn't something you had to pay for. They just added it in as an extra. You know, you bought some boxes, here you go. Have some booklets, have some clear files, have whatever. It's all Fire Emblem. We know you love it. And I think, again, the point that Cypher is a communication tool really drives it home. This is the message that Kawada P really, really repeated many times, is that Cypher is a communication tool. Now, of course, I can't talk about the community and the game itself without also talking about myself, my own experience, because that's, of course, why I'm making this video, why I'm so moved, why, you know, two card games that I love were canceled this year, but Fire Emblem Cypher's cancellation felt depressing. It felt like it just kind of struck my heart and just broke it. I don't know, it just, I immediately connected with the people, the community from Japan, you know, talked to people I never spoke of, like I didn't even know that, you know, we had common interests, and, you know, it just kind of came together and it felt so depressing when Fire Emblem Sapphire was cancelled, because for me, I knew that every single time I would go to Japan, I wouldn't be really playing Vanguard that much or playing other card games. I'd be playing Cypher, because the only place I can go and just show up to a shop and just play Fire Emblem Cypher is in Japan. And I knew that I took it for granted that the next time, you know, when borders open up and I can go to Japan, I'll be able to play Cypher. But now, I mean, that's a bit of a question mark. Shop tournaments will be ending after March 2021, and it doesn't look like we'll be allowed in Japan before then, so... I want to also preface this by saying that when Fire Emblem Cypher was announced in 2015, this was the most excited I've ever been about a card game being released. I was so excited, I'm sure long-term subscribers know this, but I was so excited that I tried to translate the rules with my friend that didn't speak such amazing Japanese, but you know, good enough to try and translate it, and then I made this video of like, just like talking about the rules, sitting on my couch in my old apartment, and just like going through it, and then like every time they announced news, I would like make a video about it, I would open boxes of every set I could, I was still like, you know, I was a student, I was barely making any money, so of course, you know, it was pretty expensive for me to do that, but I remember like always pre-ordering an Ami Ami, all the cards always being sold out on Ami Ami, or like at the top of the pre-orders, you know, the most selling product, and that was cool. That was just amazing. We never actually had a local community here in Luxembourg or anywhere nearby, really, outside of like some cities in France. So for me, I only really played, before moving to Japan, I only really played online with some friends here and there. But for me, everything really changed when I finally made that move to Japan. I had regular local tournaments to go to. I had friends that I met through the game, and I could always count on them to test and play together. Hell, I remember when I came back last summer in 2019, there was someone that I hadn't played from 2017 that they went, "Didn't we play together a long time ago?" And I was like, "Yeah, I remember you too." And then we were like, "Oh, that's cool, you know, it's cool to reconnect like that." So even though like you don't share social media or something, you can reconnect through a game, and unfortunately that won't really be the case anymore unless there's, you know, a bunch of fan-run tournaments. I still remember when there was, I think, the release of Set 11, if I'm not mistaken, where I had class in the afternoon when I was still in Tokyo, and I remember first thing in the morning, I went down to Akihabara to pick up my pre-ordered boxes, grabbed all, just everything I had, grabbed it all, and just ran back home, opened those boxes, opened those packs, went to class, then went back to my dorm, took everything, went to the local card shop after that, and me and my friends, we just traded cards from those shops, and then we sold our remaining ones and finished up our decks on day one. And that was also exciting because on day one, we could experiment with new strategies and just like try out new things that we otherwise, you know, you couldn't unless you live in Japan. And that was a very, very special part of it. And, you know, picking up all the Cypher merch. I remember there was like one card shop that for some reason had all the rare Cypher merch, and I could pick up like rare playmats that I always wished of owning but I never got to own, and that was an amazing feeling on its own. And you know, aside from just the weekly tournaments and like a lot of the offline meets that I've talked about and like the amazing community, going to Comiket for the first time, the main reason why I went is of course for Cypher, because Cypher had its own booth, and it was cool because even though we stood in line with my friend Zistral for a very long time, it was cool to see that, you know, both Young and Kawadepi, they walked around the queue, they talked to people. I managed to get a picture with Young, and I still regret to this day that I couldn't get a picture with Kawade producer, but it was so fantastic to just see all these Fire Emblem fans, you know, talking about their favorite games, their favorite installments in the franchise, their favorite decks. You know, those people in cosplay just like talking about the card game, people just like exchanging heroes, friend codes. Like, it was such a nice experience, even just queuing up there without even buying the merch. And I'll never forget how great that felt. And I'm honestly just, I wish I could experience that at least one more time. But unfortunately, you know, it's again just taking things for granted. So, this video I've talked about a lot of things, and I feel like I've talked about so much, but at the same time I've talked about nothing at the same time, just kind of giving you an impression of what things are. Of course, there's way more to this than anything I've talked about, but this was just an impression, you know, there was so much more to it. They had, like, every couple months a big live stream where they would announce things, you know, for next sets. They would do, like, special little segments where they, like, either travel to card shops or they talked about, like, you know, upcoming stuff or concerts. You know, even, like, the soundtrack, the people that worked on the soundtrack for regular Fire Emblem games would show up and like do silly things on the side or play music, you know, that's where the Cavalier duo comes from. And it's just, it's really a shame that this won't be the case anymore. It's, you know, seeing the final live stream where everyone was just getting emotional and crying about the fact that the game was ending at that. You know, they're all praying for some sort of revival, whether it's online or in person, and but just not knowing what the future is. And we didn't even know what the real reason is for the end of Cypher. You know, some people said, like, oh, it's because heroes exist, but that's not really the case. They just said that even without Cypher, these people can use heroes as a communication tool. But I mean, you know, you don't meet up with people over a mobile game, but you do for a card game. But I did look into it myself, and I saw that over the years, Cypher was making less and less money, and it was just a steep decline, and it was really unfortunate to see that. And I think they expected Three Houses to kind of work as a stimulus package for Cypher and make even more money than it actually did. But even with that said, I mean, the set and the starter deck for Three Houses sold out nationwide, so maybe they just underprinted. Maybe they, I feel like they, if they really expected it to sell more, maybe they should have printed even more, but it's hard to say. Maybe Fire Emblem just isn't sustainable enough just yet, and I think that's the reason why they never ported the game into English, and I think that would have just made them more losses than they already had, because they were very generous with this. Like, if you look at my box openings, you'll see that, like, these cards, like, the regular, like, SRs, so, like, the triple rare variant, the equivalent, they feel like SPs. They have all this texture and very special foiling. That's not easy to make. They make a special foiling and texture for every single different card that is an SR rarity. So that's not easy to make. And you know, there's so much amazing art that of course costs a lot to commission for them for this game as well. And you know, it's just, it's, of course, there's many reasons why this game might have ended, but we won't really know that ever. But you know, the best we can do is just be thankful for the days that have passed, but also look forward to the future. The sets have stopped. Set 22 is the final set, but the game has not. I've spent a lot of time talking about how this game is very unique because it's not a competitive card game. It's a game for Fire Emblem fans to get together and use it as a communication tool. And because the community isn't based around competitive play, but just jamming with your favorite characters, this can go on forever. This can go on for years. There's so many unexplored strategies, you know, you're splashing different colors, trying out different things. And I think it's because of that, it's like, as long as Fire Emblem exists, there's going to be people that maybe even pick up Cypher now in retrospect after the game has actually ended. You know, there's still plenty of places to pick up starter decks and stuff like that. But for me personally, it's also just another chapter. This is not the end of Fire Emblem Cypher. It's just another beginning of a new chapter, because I plan to, you know, make a lot of content. I uploaded a very well edited fight video, gameplay video on my second channel that I would really recommend you check out. I also have four boxes being opened on the channel for the final set, going on the main channel, because that's where Cypher began for me, on the main channel. And so if the box openings have to end, it's going to end on the main channel. But I have like match videos, deck profiles, like there's so many strategies, so many decks I built now that I never really thought about building, because I was like, you know what, I just want to have all these decks to play Cypher with. And even though they don't get updated, that's fine. I mean, I went years without updating some of my decks and they still felt fun to play, and I think that it's going to be fine. You know, if anything, you can always switch up to different strategies, pick up some different cards, and just have fun with it. Honestly, I think I really recommend anyone that was making content for Cypher, continue making content for Cypher. If you love Cypher, keep playing it. It's not the end. The community is still here, and I think it's honestly just the beginning of another chapter. Even though the game has ended, I definitely feel much more hopeful about it than I would feel about other card games ending that are more based around competitive play. On that note, however, I still have so many more things I could say. There's so much more I could say, so much more I could cover, you know, just the whole thing where at the end of the final live stream, they talked about how, you know, Kawadepi was told by card shops and, you know, financial advisors that, you know, a lot of card games end up being cancelled, especially when they're so focused on a niche, like a certain video game franchise. Even though people told him that, he still worked his hardest to make Fire Emblem Cypher the greatest game it could be, and he's very proud of it as a creation that could stand alone together with the TCG giants. And I don't know, I cried when I heard that. It really hurts to think about just how much effort this man has put into this game, and I feel like, you know, this is the least I could do. At the very least, I'm glad I covered this game for all these years. You know, I stopped covering it after 2017 when the YouTube algorithm became more rough and I couldn't upload non-Vanguard videos on the main channel anymore, but I'm glad I've covered it until now, and I plan to cover it so much more because that's the least I could do. But yeah, on that note, before I get too emotional, I think I'm gonna call it here. Thank you for watching this very different video. This is not the usual kind of content you're used to, but if you stayed around until the end, I really appreciate it. This has been something I really wanted to talk about, and I hope that I did justice to this very, very precious game that I love so much. And, you know, thank you Fire Emblem Cypher.